America's Godly Heritage. In previous editions of America's Godly Heritage, we looked at the overall picture of Pilgrim's Progress, and we began looking at the historical background of why Pilgrim's Progress was written. Today we're going to continue that by looking specifically at what was going on in England that led Bunyan to write his story. So we're now in the Reformation is beginning, and in England, we're going to jump in with a man named William Tyndale. Tyndale's another one of these people who's been reading God's Word and reading Catholic doctrine and going, some of these issues, they do not go together. We need to get the Catholic Church back in alignment with what God's Word actually says. And he got into an argument with a clergyman. He recorded it because he was so angry. And he said the clergyman actually said to him, "We are better to be without God's laws than the Pope's." Can you imagine? We can get rid of the Bible, we can get rid of God's laws, but we're not getting rid of what the Pope says. Oh my goodness. Tyndale was outraged and he said, "I defy the Pope and all his laws. If God spare me my life, ere many years, I will cause the boy that drives the plow to know more of the scriptures than you." And guess what he did? He did indeed translate the Bible into English so that people who were just normal, everyday people who had a little education could actually read the Bible for themselves. And thanks to Gutenberg and the invention of the printing press, he was able to get it mass-produced. Suddenly, lots of people in England are being able to get a hold of their own copy of the Bible, or at least parts of the Bible, and read it for themselves what it actually says. Well, the high mucky mucks didn't like this so much. Tyndale was unfortunately another martyr for this cause, and he was burned at the stake as well. He did pray as he was dying, "Lord, please open the King of England's eyes." Well, guess who the King of England was at this point in time? The infamous Henry VIII. We're going to have another little quick history lesson. Henry VIII had a problem. One of the main things a king has to do is to produce an heir who will take over the throne when he's gone. And at this point in time, you needed a son. Females, daughters, just really didn't cut it. Henry needed a son. So, political reasons, he marries Catherine of Aragon. Aragon was part of Spain. Spain is heavily Catholic. So she comes, they're married. They try many times, things do not work out. The only child they have is Mary. That's a girl. That's a problem. So Henry decides he's got to get rid of Catherine. He's got to find somebody else who will bear him a son. He appeals to the Pope for a divorce. Of course, the Pope, who's friends with Catherine's relatives back in Spain, and doctrine says, you don't get divorced. He says, well, no, I'm not going to give you divorce. Henry didn't appreciate that very much. And he also didn't like the fact that the Pope thought that he was more important, more powerful than Henry. So Henry just said, we are cutting out. We are leaving the Catholic Church. And I am now going to be in charge of the Church of England. Well, the Church of England's doctrines are very, very similar to the Catholic doctrines. They did clean up a few of the messes, but there was still a great similarity between the Church of England and the Catholic Church. One main difference is who's in charge. The Pope is no longer in charge in England. The sovereign is. The sovereign is always the leader of the Church of England. Magically, Henry could now grant himself a divorce, and he does so. Bye-bye, Catherine. So he then marries Anne Boleyn. And unfortunately for him, Anne Boleyn gives birth to Elizabeth, another girl. Oh, nuts. Long story short, Anne Boleyn is actually executed. And he marries another lady, Jane Seymour. Thank goodness Jane Seymour comes through and we have an heir. We have Edward VI. Henry dies when Edward's only 9. So, poor boy, he's now king. And he's actually kind of sickly, doesn't thrive, and he dies as a teenager. So Mary takes over. Mary's the oldest next living legitimate child. She, of course, is of the Catholic persuasion. So she pulls England back into the Catholic Church. And she proceeds to start persecuting those who have anti-Catholic beliefs and are pushing reform or Protestant doctrine. She becomes known as Bloody Mary. Fortunately for England, she also doesn't rule all that long. And then Elizabeth takes over as queen. Of course, if Henry's divorce was not legitimate, because we're back into Catholicism, then Elizabeth can't take over the throne because she is an illegitimate child. So she pulls England back into all the reforms and the Protestantism and the Church of England. Now she's safe and secure on the throne as a legitimate heir to the throne, and she actually is a very good sovereign, and she brings stability to England for decades. She's not all that interested in doctrine. She just wants stability. She wants everybody to agree to one thing, and that's that. In 1559, she does the Act of Supremacy, and that says that we are independent from Rome. We are no longer part of the Catholic Church, so it is set in stone now. She also has the Act of Uniformity, and this act requires that men, doesn't say much about women and children, but men are required to assent or agree to the Book of Common Prayers and to go to church once a week, or they're going to be fined. Maybe we need a little bit of that today. A lot of people had issues with the Book of Common Prayers because it had some of that questionable Catholic doctrine in it. Some of the problems they had was sections about communion were almost exactly the same as Catholic Mass, and they did not agree with what the Catholics said about communion in their Mass. They also did not like the fact that when they had the scriptural readings, the Book of Common Prayers included selections from the Apocrypha, which the reformers did not even agree were part of the Bible. The Catholic Church had it as part of their Bible, but not the reformers. They also did not like the fact that the Common Book of Prayer celebrated saints' days. They said that's idolatry, really. We're venerating and honoring and almost worshiping these saints, and that is not right. Now, the reason that the crown liked the Common Book of Prayer is because it did bring that uniformity in that the queen was looking for. Every single Church of England church on a particular day, oh, here it is. Here's our Bible references. Here's our prayer. Let's everybody read it. So every single church throughout the whole country went to this page and read the same set of verses and prayers. This kicked God out of the equation, didn't it? Because there was no room for maybe God wanted a certain church to have another prayer or another Bible verse that they were using. There's no room for the Holy Spirit to work, really, when you're locked into this and everybody is doing the same thing. But Elizabeth really liked it because she liked everybody being organized and doing the same things and believing the same things. And it was a bit of control because she knew exactly what was going on in every Church of England church. She did not really like the groups that said, I don't like this. We have the Puritans and the Pilgrims, which we have learned about in America's Godly Heritage. And ultimately, these groups ended up coming to America to escape the persecution that they endured in England. A little bit under Elizabeth's time, but it kept getting worse over the years, as we'll soon learn. The third group were the Presbyterians, and they were based up in Scotland. Elizabeth died in 1603, and her cousin, James I, took over the throne of England. He was already king up in Scotland, so now he's king of both Scotland and England. The Puritans were thrilled because they thought things are going to be better for us now because James is here and he's a Presbyterian. However, didn't work out. James was much more interested in power and control than he was in doctrine. He wanted things to stay the way that they were. He liked having the Church of England. He liked having that control over the religious parts of everybody's lives in England. He kind of fudged it and he said, okay, Puritans, come to me with your complaints and concerns. And he put together a group of people to pretend, it was really kind of pretend that they were listening and care. But this council was made up almost entirely of hardliners. So that didn't work out so well. But one thing that did work out well was that they created the King James Bible. And of all things, 70% of it was based on Tyndale's work. Tyndale, who'd been executed, his translation of the Bible. They were using that for the King James Bible. So more and more tightening of the screws on people who are dissenting. And we have more and more people who are deciding we're just going to have to leave. We have the separatists, otherwise known as the Pilgrims, who go to Holland and then come back briefly to England and then go to America. We have the Puritans who try to stay part of the Church of England and they just realize they can't do it. And then they soon follow the Pilgrims. 1625, things get even worse because James dies and his awful son, Charles I, becomes king. Charles was one of those kings who just thought everything he said had to happen. He was the king. Nobody had better attack him, confront him, tell him he was doing anything wrong, question him, anything like that. He was not a moral person either, let's put it that way. He really added fuel to the fire by having his buddy, his puppet friend, Archbishop Laud, L-A-U-D, rewrite the Common Book of Prayer, and then they tried to foist it onto the English in the Church of England and the Presbyterians up in Scotland. They started mocking it, and they called it Laud's Liturgy. The people of England did not like it. But the people of Scotland really didn't like it, and they actually went into full-blown rebellion in response to this book. So that just did not work at all. Things weren't just bad religiously, though, at this point in time. Charles also managed to tick off all of the political leaders as well as the religious leaders. He's back and forth for several years with Parliament. He's shutting them down because he doesn't need them because he's the king. And then he realizes, wait a minute, I don't have any money. So he brings them back specifically so that they'll give him money. And then he shuts them down again. And he keeps trying to take all the power that Parliament is supposed to have and take it onto himself. Well, finally, civil war breaks out. We have the Cavaliers, otherwise known as the Royalists, and we have the Roundheads, which is supporting Parliament. What is this term roundhead? It sounds odd. Where would that even come from? There are two main stories as to where they got their name roundhead from. The first one was that as Parliament was debating a bill called the Bishop's Exclusion Bill, the commoners were furious about this bill and they were rioting in the streets. And one of the supporters of the king drew out his sword and said he was going to cut the throats of those round-headed dogs that bawled against bishops. The other story is that the queen, Henrietta Maria, slightingly tittered to her friend, the first Earl of Stafford, who is that round-headed man over there? And it turned out it was John Pym, the head of Parliament. So in either case, it was meant as a derogatory term, but they turned it into, this is what we're going to call ourselves. Turned the whole thing right around. There was civil war from 1642 to 1649, and a man named Oliver Cromwell rose through the ranks, became head of the army, and led them to victory. He was a staunch Puritan. Now, it just so happens that our author, John Bunyan, was also part of Cromwell's army. As a teenager, he joined the army and fought for 3 years under Cromwell. When the Roundheads won, the king was on the run, tried to flee to France, they caught him, they tried him, and they executed him. Then they abolished the monarchy, and they established England as a commonwealth. It means it's a political community that was created trying to look out for the common good. We do actually have 4 non-states, they're actually commonwealths, in America. England became a commonwealth. The word wealth, you need to understand, wealth doesn't mean riches and wealth like we know it today. Wealth back then meant well-being. So it is for the common well-being, commonwealth. Since Cromwell was a Puritan, while he was the leader of England, which was about 10 years, the reform groups, particularly the Puritans, enjoyed a time of great religious freedom. Unfortunately, all of that's about to end, as we will find out in the next edition of America's Godly Heritage. I hope you have a great day. Bye!